All right, shall we go on to the next one?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, let's talk about Noah's Ark. I think this is an interesting topic because, like I said earlier, that I was kind of frustrated as a Christian. They don't really want to talk about this in church because it seems like it's divisive. But it's like, why are you afraid to explain this? The way I understand it, there's three major categories. One, the young Earth creationists will say basically that there was a worldwide flood about 6,000 years ago that destroyed all land-based creatures except for those saved on an ark, which is eight humans and some of the animals on there. Then the next branch would say, like, well, no, there is actually a local flood. This is the old Earth creationists. There's a local flood. It was a local area. Wiped out all humans. They're all local there. So therefore, you don't need to see evidence in the world, for a worldwide flood. And then the third category is actually Christians. You'd say, of course, it's a myth. It's not meant to, it's basically meant to teach you some kind of spiritual truth. It's not meant to be a historical story. So which, do you agree with those camps, or would you put yourself in a different
Yeah,
camp?
no, I think that's fair.
And then, of course,
And
Christians always mix and match. I mean, I'm saying those are like three coagulated kind of
right,
positions
there's
people can
always a
go into,
sliding
but people
scale.
always mix and match. But
Right, yeah, always a sliding scale on these things. So, yeah, I'd agree with those three classifications as a general starting point.
and so where would you, how would you come down on that?
Again, not my area of expertise. I would say that again, that you don't have to accept the flood narrative as a historical event in order to believe in God or the God of the Bible. I think it's unquestionably allegorical. And so the only question that remains is, was it historical, and if so, to what capacity? And I lean strongly towards it being historical and a little less strongly towards it being a global flood. Again, these are things, a lot of these, I do reading to kind of land on my conclusion on them. As far as being able to rearticulate the nuances of the arguments, not my strength, but I mean, I can speak to the allegorical nature pretty clearly. And then I know of some evidences for it being a historic event, and certainly, or historical event, and then, even some evidence of it being a worldwide flood or a global flood, I think is the terminology that young Earth creationists would use.
So you're tending to believe that it was not a worldwide flood, that it was a local area?
No, I would say if I had to, take a guess, I would say global. But again, I don't lean terribly strongly on that. I'm not gonna, call someone a heretic if they say that it was a local flood, or even if someone said it was allegorical. I would lean towards saying that's incorrect, but again, I could be wrong on that. But I think that, I mean, the allegorical nature of it's unquestionable, and so at the very least, you have that where it, works as an analogy for God's salvation and so on and so forth, and it's pretty intricate how the allegory plays out.
I'm kind of interested in your statement that said, you said that you're not an expert in it, so this is your opinion kind of thing, but it's like, do you really need to be an expert in this to know this kind of story? I mean, you teach at a Bible college and you write some books on apologetics. I would think that you should have an informed opinion on this.
Well, it's informed, but I mean, you understand the depth to which these arguments can go. It's never ending, and it's all postulation ultimately. It's shots in the dark. How do you interpret this data versus how do you interpret that data?
Well, I
Well,
think the
again.
yeah. Well, I think the biggest problem with the global flood idea is that there's, I would say there's, that would leave a mark on the world, a tremendous mark, and there is no mark. And somebody like Ken Ham who says, like, well, what would you expect from a global flood? Fossils laid in mud, and that's what we see. It's like that seems like a really naive view of fossils.
In what sense?
Well, for example, considering the fossils, what kind of fossils you have, where they're at, they're like certain fossils in certain geographies, which go along really well with the idea of evolution. Maybe a bigger idea is that they're sorted in order of complexity. I mean, it's kind of a joke that, well, there was a worldwide flood, but the waters were smart enough to sort them out according to complexity. you put the, you know, the least complex at the bottom and the more complex at the top, like evolution says. I mean, the, and then just to think, like, you know, there'd be fresh water, and this is what a lot of people say is, like, it, you know, it's kind of silly to think that there's fresh water and the salt water mixing up everything. You know, if it was all ocean water, there's freshwater fish that could not survive in salt water, and I think vice versa. And then just to think, oh yeah, you know, the polar bears have to get to the Ark, and the penguins have to get to the Ark, and then they have to get back to where they went. The kangaroos and all that, all these animals that you find on different continents had to get to the Ark and then back to where they were going. It just seems kind of ridiculous.
Well, see, and so that's where why I said what I said, as far as the nuances of this stuff are never ending. You know, you can always come up with, well, what about this? What about this? What about this? And there are people who make a career out of answering those questions. That's just not the area I've chosen in my short time as a Christian to focus.
Yeah. Well, you know, and
I've looked into them, yeah. But as far as being able to sit here and, you know, you come up with a million, or not a million, you know, but constant, like, well, what about this? What about this? What about this? I'm just not the person that you should be talking to about that particular question. But I can point you in a direction of people who can.
Well, who would you point me to for that?
Well, I mean, like you said, you know, if you want to look at a young Earth, the evidence for the young Earth, I'd probably point you towards the Hovinds or the Hams of the world. And if you wanted to look at maybe the localized flood, I'd point you more in the direction of the Rosses and gentlemen like that.
You know, one thing that was weird, I'll tell you, I went to this meeting where there's these professionals, and it's called the American Scientific Affiliation, ASA group, and they're basically a group of Christians who have advanced degrees, usually at least a bachelor's degree, and a lot of them are like seminary professors. Some of them are in science and some of them are in theology. And one of these guys came to, while I was a Christian, he came to this school and gave a talk, basically introduced the group. And I asked a question. I said, what do you think about the flood? Was it local or global? Because I really wanted to learn. And he basically dodged and said, well, some believe this, some believe that. And so I was kind of disappointed he didn't really say the answer. And he kind of said, oh, there's somebody else in the room here that could, you know, tell you some more. So then I talked to the guy at the end of the room. And you know, he's like, well, of course it was, you know, it's a myth, you know. And so that was kind of interesting. So like when somebody asks you, you know, how do you interpret this? And you say, well, here's these different opinions. That's what I found kind of frustrating, I guess, because they're not really providing any answers. It's just saying, go look in these different positions. But
well, but like Bernie, if you really wanted to search out those answers, and I mean, I'm saying in a different context, maybe like if you were someone who was really seeking these answers, and if I was acting in a pastoral capacity, what I would do is I'd say, you know, what are your specific questions? I might not have all those answers right now, but you know what? Why don't we go find those together, and we can look at the different things. And I've done that for people, not on this specific issue, but you know, someone came to me and they were questioning about the Apocrypha, for example, and I didn't have a ton of information on that. Again, it was something that I had researched enough to get my own piece on, but I wasn't ready to rearticulate the arguments to someone. Mm-hmm. And so I went and I spent, I don't know, probably 20 hours with them, just going through bit by bit, saying, okay, now how, you know, here's the evidence for this, here's the evidence against it, let's look at experts on both sides of the field and come to some kind of a reasonable conclusion together. Okay. So I would say that I'd agree with you. It's a shame that that's the way it was left for you. I don't think they're wrong to just say, hey, here's the different views and there's more information available, but I personally would take it a step further, whereas if you're really trying to seek that information, then I'm going to make myself as available as possible to get you some resources or even walk through it with you hand in hand. So well, I would call that more of a pastoral failure than maybe a scientific failure.
Well, I think the person that I asked that, I think he actually had a position and thought it was, you know, a myth, but he didn't. But he was playing political and didn't want to, you know, hurt any feelings or take a position, especially since he's speaking to a crowded group, because he's trying to appeal to everybody. Their organization has young Earth and old Earthers and, you know, evolutionary creationists in it. So he was just trying to give a political answer. So
right.
Okay. So
again, for me, these just aren't, you know, huge game changers for me, because I think you can reasonably read the Bible and get it just as allegorical. And now I think there is also there is a case for the historic usage of it, and so I think there's something to be said for that. Mm-hmm. But I don't think you have to if it wasn't a historic event. And you can go into the evidences. You know, I saw a clip the other day about that they're exploring the structure on Mount Ararat. They've dated the wood at 4,800 years. It's a multi-level massive structure that they're actually going inside of. And, you know, is it the Ark? I don't know. You know, time will tell. If it is, well, that would say that at least something happened there. That wouldn't prove a global flood, but, you know, that would be at least a local. And maybe it's not it. But that doesn't mean, again, that's not a disproof necessarily. So,
yeah, that'd be good to look into facts like that, because sometimes you find people are actually lying. I mean, like, for example, one time
who the source was for this one, and these aren't the type of people that would be lying.
Well, one time I was at a debate, and somebody asked me about what about life after death, and you know, there's people who have died and went to hell or heaven. And it's like, yeah, well, and there's this one kid they wrote a story about who went. I think it was, I can't remember if it was heaven or hell. And later on, the kid admitted it was all a sham.
Right,
but, you know, here's the book in the Christian bookstores.
You've got a lot of Christians who will tell you that that's not even, that would be unscriptural to say that, too.
Yeah. Okay, so we go on to the next topic?
Yeah, sure, that works for me.
Sounds like this might be your favorite one, morality.
Yeah, I'm. This is